Once again, welcome to our series on quality controls. Up until now, we were talking about LJ charts and the monitoring of LJ charts. And from this video onwards, I'm going to tell you some extra concepts in quality controls. It would be good to understand these concepts. However, these are not at this point mandatory for your NABLE accreditation, but it would be good to understand what these concepts are. These concepts will be explained very briefly so that you can get a preliminary orientation about these things. If you want to read more details, please refer to the QC module which is on the website, volume 1, which will give you some more additional information about the concepts in that we are going to talk about. And more details will be available on the WESGUARD site for more reading and in-depth understanding of these concepts. So, we are going to start with bias. What is bias? How can we determine if a change is acceptable or not? If you look at this slide, up until now we were talking about the Levy-Jennings chart, which alerts us to any changes in accuracy and in precision or imprecision. But then there is an additional aspect here, which is the understanding of bias, and which together with the LJ will monitor and evaluate the full method performance. And to understand the method performance fully, LJ may not be enough. I'll tell you why in a little while. So, this is your full method evaluation of your ongoing method performance, which includes definitely LJ, and also additionally understanding of the bias will give you some more in-depth details of what could be going wrong with your system. And now let's recap. Accuracy is the closeness of the measurement to the true value. Bias is the difference between the expectation of the result and the accepted reference value. We'll talk about what is the accepted reference value in a little bit. Precision, we already have understood it well, the amount of variation in the measurements. And what is the error and what are the actions? This also we have talked about. Inaccuracy leads to bias because of systematic errors. Easy to detect and correct because many of the causes are correctable. Imprecision or random errors, it's more difficult to detect and eliminate. If it's good to have mechanisms to quantify both. So, let's look at diagrammatic representations once again. This is your inaccuracy or bias, and this is your both inaccuracy and imprecision because there's a lot of variation in the results. And this is an accurate and precise results. And this particular video, we are going to concern about ourselves with this understanding of bias, and we are trying to calculate and quantify bias in this video. So, how do you detect and how do you quantify bias is the question. So, we have already seen that LJ charts can sort of alert you about shifting accuracy and bias formation, but can you quantify it, the bias there? It's not possible. And how do you do it? Some ICWAS also alerts you to bias occurring. So, to quantify bias, you need to understand the true value, and you need to have a mechanism whereby you can have an idea what is the true value. As we talked about, unless you know what this or the true value is, how will you quantify the bias? So, the question here is, how will you know the true value? Who will tell you the true value and how do you know it is true? These are the questions that we need to answer if you have to quantify bias. So, let's just put this as an example and see, suppose this is the true value and this is your mean, this will be your bias. This will be your bias and you need to have a mechanism to quantify the bias. Calculation of bias is our next question in concern. Bias is equal to your mean value minus true value. This indicates the change in the analytical system. Also, when you say x dash minus true value, it's already implied that error will have a direction, either negative or positive direction. Observed mean, if it is more than the true value, the bias is positive, and if the observed mean is less than the true value, the bias is negative. Let's see how this works. So, now the calculation of absolute bias. Two more terms are important here, absolute bias and percent bias. Since total error or TE calculations, which we will talk about shortly, involve the sum of the bias and the imprecision, bias has to be converted into an absolute number. Even if the bias is a negative number, you need to make it an absolute number, and absolute number is just taking the minus sign off. If it is a minus 4 bias, absolute bias is equal to 4. It's as simple as that. So that you convert everything into a positive number, and this is required for the calculation of the total error. Absolute bias percent is equal to absolute bias divided by the true value into 100. That will convert it into a percent. So the denominator here is the true value. We'll see it in a few calculations here. This is your mean, your lab mean, but the true value is 86. So what is the bias here? Your mean minus true value is equal to plus 4. The bias of plus 4 is seen in this picture. And if you look at this picture, lab mean is 86, true value is 90, so the bias is minus 4. So the absolute number in both these cases is just 4. Now the next question is, where will you get the true value from and what makes it true? Source here is your inter-laboratory comparison programs, which is given by your internal QC manufacturer. We had talked about this when we talked about different kinds of quality controls, purchasing your quality controls, and when you start, this is a question that you have to ask your provider. Do you give inter-laboratory comparison program available? Do you make it available? Will you give me the peer group data? There are multiple terms used for this. The peer group data is the most commonly used word. Will you give me the peer group data? Because this is a very important thing, because this allows you to go further in your understanding of your analytical systems. So good QC providers give monthly as well as cumulative means. Very important, monthly means, cumulative means. The cumulative means are very robust values and will give you very good anchoring for as a true value. I'll show you an example now. If you don't have the interlaboratory comparisons, you may use a manufacturer's assigned mean, but there are multiple pitfalls about it. We have already talked about why it is not an advisable thing not to use the manufacturer's assigned mean to plot your charts. So you have to put a question mark there. Is it a good valid method to ascertain the true value? Possibly not. And if you don't have that also, you may as well use your long-term lab mean, provided your system has been stable over a period of time. These two options are not good options. Your best option in understanding your true value is your peer group number. So once again, to recap, there are three mechanisms whereby you can understand your bias. Your LJ charts will alert you to a development of a bias because you see emerging populations and shifting accuracy. Your request program will alert you to possibility of bias. I'll show you pictures of that in a little while. And the most important resource that you have is your peer group. And you should try to have the true value of the peer group through deciding on the purchase of your QC material by asking for the peer group comparisons as far as possible. So this is how a peer group comparison works. There is the IQC provider or the internal quality control provider, what they do is they take your values. These are the red arrows which say at the end of every day or every defined period of time, maybe a month, some programs even take your values daily, and you feed your values back to the provider. The provider will analyze the values and find a cumulative mean of all the participants, cumulative mean, standard deviation, and then they'll tell you how you are placed in that program, how much of deviation you have got. Even if they don't give you the feedback on your deviation, you can ask for the cumulative numbers so that you can compare the numbers yourself. That is another option. So there is unlimited participants here, and you already know, you have an idea of the value because you have been analyzing it in your lab, and you can do it on a daily frequency also, and monthly. There are multiple options available. You have to understand these from your internal QC providers. So this is an example of a report of a peer group report. And here, if you see, there are so many facts which are displayed here. Understand all the details. This is the lot number here, expiry, and you know which lot that you are talking about. And this is the parameter, bilirubin direct. The method is given there. This is your level 1 values. These are your level 2 values. And in the level 1 values, in both these levels, you have got the mean, the standard deviation, the CV. This is the aggregated value of all the participants, and they also give you how many data points they have used. So, in the peer group of this, this is the monthly and this is the cumulative one. In this month, there were 2,572 data points which they used to calculate from 103 laboratories. But if you look at the cumulative, there are 22,000 data points from 151 laboratories, and that is the mean that they have asked. So, you can just imagine how robust that mean is going to be. You have got 22,000 data points in both these L1 and L2, and so the mean that you are going to get is a very robust mean, and it can be your anchoring value. It is the best estimate of the true value that if you have a very robust peer group program. So, you have to ask your provider for this. This is one take home message here, that while you are purchasing your internal controls, please ask that you get enrolled in the peer group program. Second, now question is detecting systematic errors through LJ charts. We said there are three options. One is your LJ, second is your peer group or wherever you are getting a target value, and third is EQA. So, now we will talk about LJ. LJ we already covered. These are the rules which will alert you to a buildup of a systematic error, 2-2S, 3-1S, 4-1S, 70 and the X rules, 6, 8, 10 and 12 rules. And here the problem is you cannot quantify the errors. You can only know that there is an error. So, there is a difference. When you can quantify, it makes more sense. That is where the peer group becomes very important. But having said that, it does not invalidate your need to do corrective actions when you see any of the errors building up. We discussed all these things earlier. So, I will not repeat these now. And your third mechanism is your EQAS. EQAS also gives you your comparison with respect to, when we started your discussion, we had pointed this out that EQAS is one of the ways in which you can assess your accuracy or inaccuracy, which is what is pointing to bias. So, generally the Z scores are given, or the equivalent of that, sometimes they call it SDI scores or Z scores, they mean the same thing. So, if you look at that, that will give you some idea of your bias buildup. And I have just underlined one randomly, which does not mean anything. This is your Z score here, -1.58. Most of the analytes here are showing a negative direction. One analyte is even going -2.4. The acceptance limit, the warning level for Z score is at 2, plus or minus 2, that means you are going, you are showing a bias beyond your peer acceptability. So, this one analyte is showing -2. And when you see a system like this, when a lot of things are going to onto the negative direction, you might want to consider what exactly is going wrong here. Maybe one of the things you would think is even reconstitution of the EQAS sample, though there are some of them which are in the positive direction, but not much in the positive direction. So, you need to troubleshoot. We'll talk about this in the video on EQAS and the interlaboratory comparisons. For the time being, we need to understand that the biases can also be understood through the EQAS reports. This is an example. This is another example of a detail of one analyte alkaline phosphatase, which is showing a consistent negative bias. Such a thing should not be allowed to happen in a lab. This is a report which tells you that the people who have been enrolled in this program has not been looking at their reports. If this is not acceptable, every sample is in the negative. This is your 0, and so this is like an LJ like graph. It is not an LJ graph, it is something that you graph similar to the LJ, and you are showing the samples, every sample in August, September, October, November, December, over almost a period of 1 year, it is going in the negative direction. So, this should not be allowed. This is not acceptable, because if you are looking at the reports, you would make some kind of a remedial action here. And this kind of plotting is called Yund plotting. Yund plotting is concentration of the analyte wise. So, this analyte has been plotted at 81.5, at 170 and 217, 417, 576. So, at all concentrations, the analyte is showing a negative bias. So, that means the curve is negative, the analytical curve is negative across all clinical decision levels. So, these are things which the people who are enrolling to EQAS also have a very good idea about your analytical system's performance, and this should be monitored and corrected. And this is another LJ-like and Yund plot. Here you are seeing the there is a up and down, it is not consistently on one side, but if you are looking at the higher concentrations, there are only too little, too few to make any judgment on. But if you look at some of the values are clustered there. So at certain points, like at the lower values are all showing a negative bias, and in at the medium values they are pretty okay, and at the higher values there is a shift to the upper side. So you may need to look at the calibrations when you have such kind of a plotting happen. Again, this is over a period of 1 year, so you analyze the data keeping everything in mind. Another plotting for AST, and that again shows negative bias at the higher concentrations, but the other concentrations are okay, but it is not a significant bias, but there is a slight shift there. So these are points that you can consider and look at and make remedial actions about if required. This technically does not need any corrective action, but the first one, the alkaline phosphatase chart, definitely is a thing which calls for a corrective action. These are just to illustrate the this kind of graphing. And now to recap, we already know the reasons for systematic error. We will just once again go through the trends and shifts. The trend is a gradual loss of reliability in the test system, and these are the causes: deterioration of the instrument light source, we already talked about it, gradual accumulation of debris, aging reagents, deterioration of control material, and deterioration of the incubation chamber temperature, and most importantly and most easily correctable, calibration deterioration. So you have to eliminate causes 1 to 5, and last example you have to just recalibrate so that you need to find the thing. This is one example of how a calibration can do a correction of your bias. Here you have a value of an analyte which is showing 103, and the true value is 110, and there is a bias of minus 7 here, and once you recalibrate, this is your graph after calibration, you see that you have immediately pulled it up. Your true values here and your values, the current mean is just come up, because that is as simple as that. If you recalibrate, that is the most importance of having a good calibration schedule developed for your lab. So this is it about the concept of bias and how you can calculate that. Even if you are not calculating, you need to understand if the biases are developing. And one take home message is, while you are purchasing your QCs, please include peer group programs into that. Thank you.